It's always great to be at such conferences. I thank the organizers very much for inviting me here. So I decided to speak about a very narrow subject, which still is getting some attention in last years. And there are plenty of puzzles there and a lot of things to work on. So I decided to touch it here. Though unfortunately, it will be very technical and unfortunately boring. And that's a pity because, as we just discussed with Samson, this hall is very good for performing singing and dancing. And so if I knew this in advance, I would try to take something more entertaining. But anyhow, so I shall not tell you any plan of this talk because there is no plan. And this is rather a collection of fragments of different observations, which can be ordered in many different ways, of course, and put in different logical sequences. But unfortunately, I don't know what is the right one. And therefore, I try to be more or less objective and don't put them in any particular order. So there is also a list of people which taught me different parts of the story. Most of them are students. And one of them, Shamil Shakirov, is already in States. Two others will be there in August, Smirnov and Galakhov. Some others will follow, hopefully. And I'm sure that you'll enjoy meeting these people many times, also at these conferences in the future. So first of all, what is the Beta deformation? There are plenty of ways to try to explain this, but most, probably the most simple one, which is good for the for the early school, is just to recall what is the Dedekind function, sorry, at the top. And that's a beautiful thing which appears in many places in string theory, and it counts the number of two-dimensional partitions. And this is the way of putting squares in a corner, or just a way to enumerate partitions of integer into other integers. It has a very old famous counterpart, the Smac-Mahon function, which counts a number of possibilities to put several cubes into a corner of a room. That's one of the biggest puzzles of modern mathematics, modern combinatorics. What is the analog of these functions when you put four-dimensional cubes in the corner of four-dimensional room and so on? It appears to be a highly non-trivial problem, but let me not go into this. Instead, in this Smac-Mahon formula, there is an essential difference from the Dedekind function. The power is strange. And of course, there is an obvious way to get rid of these strangers, just to switch to another generating function, introducing an additional parameter t. Then when t goes to q, we obtain the Smac-Mahon function. And therefore, it is natural that the problem should have a deformation in the direction of this t variable. And this is basically the reason why, looking at this very simple problem, you already understand that q is not enough and that there should be another direction of deformation. More formally, the story is about the theory of characters. So everybody, I hope, knows what are SLN characters, so-called Schur functions, which I denote S. They depend on representation of SLN algebra. They depend also on infinitely many times, which, if you like, you can trade for these X variables, which are eigenvalues of some n by n matrix. X here. And so it is very well known in the representation theory that that the theory of characters has a strange deformation to the so-called MacDonald polynomials. It is strange because we still don't know what is the relevant group behind all this, but we know that almost all the formulas which exist for Schur functions can be immediately deformed in this direction by introducing an additional parameter in the story. So formally, one of the definitions, one of the many definitions which we know for Schur functions is that they are eigenvalues of some operators. So the example is given here. So in general, these are today called cut and join operators. The name comes from probably Horvitz theory or topological theories. And there is a whole interesting science about this. And in particular, so all these characters are eigenfunctions of this whole bunch of commuting operators. It's not very obvious that they commute, but they do. So there are common eigenvalues of all these operators and the eigenfunctions, sorry. And eigenvalues are also interesting quantities. They are called characters of symmetric groups and also quite interesting things. Another possibility to look at these polynomials is to say that they are orthogonal with respect to some measures. So the ordinary characters are orthogonal with respect to this usual van der Mond thing. And so this measure can be deformed in these two steps. And so the polynomials which you get in the same way instead of sure functions in the last case are exactly these MacDonald polynomials. So you just saw this picture in the previous talk, only it was inverted. What was at the top now is at the bottom. So because I am trying to say that we start from something well known, these sure functions, then we can go in two different directions. We can go to quantum algebras and we can go to these beta ensembles. Beta ensembles are the ones which correspond to switching from the first measure to another, to the second one. And finally, you can make these Bode deformations and get to this space of MacDonald polynomials. So there are corresponding parameters which describe these deformations. The ones which go to the left are Q deformations. The others which go to the right are these beta deformations. So the relation between Q and T is this strange relation. And all this is, as Samson just mentioned, well known in the theory of integrable systems and thus in all other stories which are already related to them. So the upper part is called the theory of Calogero systems. The lower part is called the theory of Fregenal systems. From the point of view of Zyberg-Witten correspondence with Young-Mills theories, the switch from Calogero to Rudgenars corresponds to going from 4 to 5 dimensions. Now, in many other languages, it means many other things. But in any case, this direction from Calogero to Rudgenars, this Q deformation, is very straightforward. It is known under the name of quantum groups and very well studied. So we understand almost everything there. What we don't understand at all, what is much less studied, is this going from left to the right, this beta deformation. So what substitutes sure functions in that case are first these Jack polynomials, when there is only beta, but it is much more profitable to introduce Q from the very beginning, and then we live with these MacDonald polynomials. Just what differs my slide from that of Samson is that I will give you a couple of examples. So this is how this first MacDonald polynomials look like. So the indices are labels of representations, labels of Jung diagrams. So in the case of fundamental representations, those which contain only one total antisymmetric representations, these are just the same things as sure functions. They are not deformed. But in a lot of cases, they are deformed. And the only example which I give is this last line, which shows what happens when you introduce Q and T. When T equals Q, we return back to sure functions. And what we get here is just P2 plus P1 squared, almost the same as M11, only with a sign switched. Another important set of formulas are the what one can call quantum dimensions or MacDonald dimensions, whatever word you prefer. This is the restriction of these polynomials to a very special subset parameterized by just one letter, A. So instead of these infinitely many time variables, we put all of them equal to this ratio. And also I introduce this notation to denote what stands in the numerator. So this A is often traded for the letter N, and this letter N appears in our physical applications usually. This is the size of the group in particular. So here are some examples of application of this formula. I also show what happens to them when T goes to Q. So they become just ordinary quantum dimensions. If also Q goes to one, these are just dimensions of representations themselves. So all this, I hope, is very well known. There is also a general formula for this quantum dimension. So it is the typical example of Hook formulas. So you take a Jung diagram, which labels our, which describes our representation. So pick up some particular point in this diagram. Then there are four numbers, I distance from here, J distance from here, L distance from here, and K distance from here. And then this strange quantity is a product of these trivial factors over all the points of the diagram. For those who know about any class of functions, especially the five-dimensional analogs, all this is very much familiar because these are almost the same formulas. The only thing which we should already mention here at this stage, and this is going to be one of the serious challenges after that, is that these quantities are not polynomials in Q and T, even if we put this A equal to T to the power N. So you see that because of these Qs there, you cannot divide numerator over denominator whenever there are Qs. There are no Qs when it is a fundamental representation. This small fact will have dramatic consequences at the end of this talk, if I ever reach it, which will concern knots. Now, what for I was saying all this? The point is that this strange and very formal things, which are interesting by themselves, today they start to appear in our theories. So we are forced to look at them. Even if we were not interested, we need to do this now. And I mentioned just two examples. There are many more, but just two. Before I mention these examples, I want to mention another thing that that's an old story, as I said, and this Betti deformation is a very funny thing. In particular, there are, in some problems at least, there are phase transitions in this beta which look very strange at the values of beta equal 100. Something happens. So there are a lot of interesting results in this field, but not all of them, unfortunately, are already in the mainstream of our studies. But these two examples are definitely in the mainstream, and therefore we are forced to look at all this. Well, the first example is just the AGT relation, Aldai-Gayota-Tachikawa. And no, conceptually, it says that we computify our six-dimensional conformal field theory, which we know or don't know, well, on two-dimensional Riemann surface. And this allows us to connect something in four dimensions with something in two dimensions. What Aldai, Gayota, and Tachikawa achieved, they managed to make it into a concrete statement. Nobody says that this is a unique statement, but at least this one is certainly true. It says that conformal blocks in two dimensions are identified with LMNS integrals over instanton moduli spaces. LMNS is Losev, Moore, Nekrasov, Shadashvili. And in this identification, just the simplest formula to look at is this formula for the central charge. And we see that if we want to get the central charge different from 1 or from n minus 1 in general case, we need to introduce this letter beta. That's exactly the beta which is going to describe beta deformation. There are also more familiar parameterizations in terms of this epsilon parameters. And sometime this parameterization is better, sometime it is not. But from algebraic point of view, it is more standard to look at beta, and in many respects, it's really the right coordinate there. Though some very funny things happen in the limits when epsilon, one of the epsilons goes to zero, then we get this Nekrasov-Shatashvili limit, which is very interesting by itself. It takes us from ordinary integrable systems to quantum integrable systems. What happens in general for general beta, we simply don't know. And also, I should mention already at this stage, these LMNS integrals are nicely decomposed into something very nice. These are Nekrasov functions, which are very similar to these MacDonald dimensions, which I mentioned. These are nicely factorized quantities. That's an additional fact, which needs to be understood somehow, especially in this context of this AGT relation. And as we will see, this is not so simple to do. It's simple to do for beta equal 1, but things are much more complicated for beta different from 1, and this is another challenge. So another example is what I would roughly call 3D, AGT, whatever this can mean. Again, the idea is that all this, that this should be something which now involves something similar to three-dimensional Chern-Simons theory and the theory of knot invariance. So different people think different things of what this 3D AGT can be. In fact, there can be many such relations, maybe even no such relations, whatever. One of the last interesting attempts was to connect just modular properties of conformal blocks with knot invariance directly, using the fact that these modular transformations are described in terms of some quantum d-logarithm functions, d-gamma functions, and knot invariants are also described in terms of these functions in the program of Hikami, in the theory of Hikami invariants. Some, they indeed look very similar, though some things don't quite match there, so that's a difficult story, and I'll not go into this at the moment. So I'm not going to refer so much to the relation itself, which is still obscure, but instead I will try to emphasize the story about knot invariants themselves, which are part of this future correspondence, whatever it is going to be. And the point there is that we know that from Chern-Simons theory we can get some knot invariants, which are encoded in terms of so-called Homfli polynomials, which depend on two parameters, A and Q. So no, Q is this time made from coupling constant. A is made from the size of the group. And it is pretty well known and that, in fact, the really interesting quantity is different. These are these things called super polynomials, which just count this number of BPS states, which Ed was telling us about a little earlier. And it is definitely a puzzle how to evaluate these super polynomials. They are not directly made from Chern-Simons theory because they have this additional parameter T in there, which is related to this beta non equal to one. They don't seem to have an interpretation in terms of indices, at least they don't immediately have such interpretations. It's not very clear how to really handle them. So that's a puzzle. One of the nice ways to formulate the puzzle is just to write this super polynomial in some simple form, just to decompose into, as a function of A, it can be decomposed as in a linear combination of these MacDonald dimensions, which also depend on A, and there will be some coefficients, and the question is what these coefficients are. So they, of course, depend on the knot. They are rational functions of Q and T. And what is remarkable is that for toric knots, these coefficients are simple. They can be calculated. This is a very well-known story in the theory of Homfli polynomials, and it has immediate deformation to the MacDonald case. And there are some puzzling questions concerning non-toric knots. Now, of course, there are many more reasons to believe in it. Nice formulas of index type exist for toric knots than in general, but still, amusingly, in some cases, coefficients are rather simple for non-toric knots as well. Nobody understands at the moment what it means. This formula is going to be an example of what I call W representation, and this W representation will have a natural deformation into beta direction. So, to finish the story about beta deformation in general, so we should say what we expect to survive and to break down under this beta deformation when we switch from beta equal one to somewhere else. It appears that everything what is directly related to character calculus, of course, not surprisingly, everything survives. It's maybe a little more surprising to see what are these things related to character calculus. First of all, these are the Zyberg-Witten equations, which were already mentioned by Samson in his last talk, and they in turn imply quasi-classical integrability, WDVV equations, and all other kinds of stuff. It looks like also everything related to Virasoro constraints survive, in particular this, this topological recursion, broadly advertised by NR during last years, which has incredible number of applications. So this is another formulation of what the Virasoro constraints are. So these W representations, which I mentioned, are going to survive. Definitely AGT relations are going to survive. Hopefully, something will survive about knot invariants. As I say, definitely everything survives for toric knots, but maybe also something else survives. What doesn't survive, what is lost, is everything related to KP integrability of partition functions. There are many aspects in which integrability enters the game. So what Samson mentioned today is, in my context, something what I prefer to call quasi-classical integrability, though sometimes it is quantum, but it's quantum in another parameter. But there is a really full integrability of partition functions, which I call KP integrability, which allows to describe this dependence on these time variables in terms of KP or Toda class hierarchies. And at the moment, nobody knows what happens to this integrability after beta deformation. And because of this, many important things break down. First of all, breaks down all kinds of determinantal representations. So there is still no consensus on what should be the beta deformed determinant, which is universal and applicable in all relevant problems. What is very important is Harrod-Zagier recursion, the more sophisticated and deep analog of this NR topological recursion. This one breaks down, also breaks down many things related to Kontsevich matrix models. So we should at the moment we need to sacrifice something, though everybody who works in this field believes that one day this will be restored, so we will invent the right deformation of this notion as well, but not now. And another part, which is in a funny way broken down, is the thing which we had definitely, which we know well from the study of AGT relations, for example, that our quantities get decomposed into something very nice. Natural quantities which we calculate get decomposed into some nice factorized functions, like Nekrasov functions are the good example. So you have this LMNS function, which is rather sophisticated integral, and it can be decomposed into a sum of some interlinear combination of some very simple factorized objects similar to those MacDonald dimensions. So what happens is that this decomposition, it exists, but we don't understand, or at least I don't understand, how to make it natural. The problem is that the natural quantities, which arise definitely in this theories, do not decompose into these factorizable quantities. An example of natural quantity, for those who know what it is Adler-Selberg correlators. I'll probably tell something about this later. The Selberg correlators in description of AGT relation. And so for beta equal 1, these Selberg correlators are nicely factorized, and they're simply equal to Nekrasov functions. But for beta different from 1, there is a nice decomposition of the conformal block into a combination of the Selberg correlators. But to get them further factorized, you need additional linear transformation to this Nekrasov function. And it's not just a question of linear transformation. The problem is that the LMNS function has different poles than individual Nekrasov functions. Nekrasov functions have more poles than the object that we are trying to calculate. The conformal block has poles at the zeros of Katz determinant, and everybody knows that Nekrasov functions have more poles which are beyond this zeros of Katz determinant. And so somehow we decompose our quantity into a combination of nice things, but which have additional, maybe not quite expected properties. Something very similar is going to happen for knots, especially for link invariants. Again, the super polynomials for knots, which are the right objects there, can be decomposed, of course, into this nicely factorized MacDonald dimensions. But again, the structure of poles is different. MacDonald dimensions have more poles than the super polynomial, as I mentioned at the very beginning. So that's another kind of deep problem. OK, so a few words about matrix models. Matrix models are integrals of this type originally, with some measure delta of x made from one or another kind of Vandermonde. One day, we hope that such integrals can be calculated in full generality. There is a whole science, nonlinear algebra devoted to this kind of things. The trick is that, as Gelfand observed many years ago, linear algebra is in no way distinguished. Just whatever we know about linear algebra can immediately be generalized to a nonlinear case, to the systems of homogeneous equations. Just the only thing which you should do, you should substitute the word determinant by the word discriminant or resultant, and everything works without any minor change. Unfortunately, though this should be taught at the undergraduate school, it is not taught, and almost nobody knows about this. Anyhow, just to give you a very simple example that science can exist just as well as the first integral can be calculated, for example, the cubic integral can also be calculated. That's, of course, a very simple formula. In general, it is more sophisticated, but usually even these kinds of integrals are controlled by this simple quantities called discriminants. No, conceptually simple. One of the reasons why this field was not developing was that it is very difficult to write formulas for discriminants. Only modern computer facilities allow to do this in big enough quantity to get some insights. Now, anyhow, so we don't know how to take these integrals explicitly at the moment. And that's actually for good, because of this, we should rely upon very different approaches. And that's important because these different approaches open our eyes and show for us a lot of hidden structures, which are not obvious from the very beginning. No, these are two standard things. I'll not tell any more about this. These matrix models usually satisfy some of what identities called Virasoro constraints, and they have some hidden integrable structure, this KP structure, which in fact is the second thing, is broken on the Betta deformation into something unknown. What is more interesting, these quantities have this loop genus expansion, and in perturbation theory, this F0, for example, is the sum just over planar diagrams. And why it is important? It is important because looking at this F0, we can observe some new hidden structure which was not a priori present in the integral. This is the spectral curve, and everything what one can define with the help of this curve. And you can define a lot. For me, just two things will be important. It allows us to define what is called resolvence, and it allows us to define what is the Zeiber-Quinton equations. So resolvents are correlators of this type, and there is no a priori reason to choose exactly these correlators. But if you do this, you observe that they are very nicely consistent with the spectral curve. In fact, all these rows are just polydifferentials on the spectral curve. Moreover, Virasoro constraints imply some relations between these differentials, which allow you to construct them one after another by some recursion scheme, this inert topological recursion. At the same time, this choice of generating functions has a drawback. As any loop expansion, it tends to diverge. Just the sum over loops is divergent. And in particular, it is a little problematic to define in this way what is this last quantity, which is the sum over all genera for already a one-point function. It cannot be restored in this simple way. And that's bad, because this one-point function plays a big role. It is exactly the Zeiber-Quinton differential in the formula for the full partition function. Everybody knows these formulas for F0, for genus 0, then it is rather simple. But in fact, there is a strong belief in matrix model theory that it holds not only for all matrix models, not for full free energies, but even it survives Betta deformation. And there are some evidence in favor of this. So there is an important problem in this kind of theories, how to calculate this omega, how to calculate this sum. And the answer is Just to give you an example of how it works, why the Zyber-Kwitnik equations are true for the full partition function, just it's enough to look at this Gaussian example of a Gaussian integral, so which you can take exactly. The answer is known to be a product of the k factorials. That's nothing but the inverse volume of the unitary group, actually. And amusingly, or not amusingly, it satisfies this last equations at the bottom, what one can check. It is not very easy to generalize this formula to non-Gaussian case. That's a whole subject of the theory of intergraph alpha phases in these models, but there are many contours on spectral curve which is, has higher genera. So it's a whole business, but one believes that it works. So the question is, what is the way out of this problem of calculating this omega? And the way out is known very well. You should switch to another kind of generating functions which will converge. If you put more factorials on the bottom, of course, things will start being convergent. And so there are these two obvious choices. The last one is absolutely obvious. It's a correlator of exponents instead of 1 over z minus x. But in the middle one is a better thing, which is the minimal number of factorials you should introduce. And this thing is called Harrod-Sagir function. And it can be explicitly evaluated. No, that's the old result of Harrod and Sagir themselves. And they also noticed that it becomes even simpler if you make another generating functions switching from n to this lambda. So then the answer is simply elementary, trivial elementary function. And this thing has generalizations. For example, two-point function of this kind can also be evaluated, and it's again elementary function. Moreover, three-point function is also made out of arctangences, and probably all the rest is also made, but that's already a difficult story. Once we calculated this this phi, it is easy to come back to resolvents, for example, to this row which we need. So it's a simple integral transformation back. And you see now that this double factorial appears in the numerator if we expand it. And this is why the series was actually divergent. But of course, since it is an integral transform, you can easily choose some regularization or whatever, some branch, which can be expressed in terms of in a closed form of a function. And all this nice or terrible technique, whatever you think about this, doesn't have immediate generalization to beta different from one. It has, of course, generalizations to this group points, beta equal 2 and 1 over 2, but already for beta equal 3, instead of algebraic equations for these functions, you get something terrible, some differential equations, and that's one of the results of the breakdown of naive integrability in this story. Another important subject in matrix model story is these W representations. So the point is that these partition functions of matrix models, which are complicated functions of the time variables which appear there, have also a very simple representation of this type in the middle of the slide. So they appear as acting with some simple cut and join operator on something absolutely trivial called tau zero here. So the example of W operator is written at the bottom. And the examples of formulas are here. So this is just the usual Hermitian matrix model. So in the role of tau zero stands just exponent of P zero, something absolutely trivial. The whole thing is reproduced just by acting with this W operator. Similar things exist for Kantsevich model, for Hurwitz model, and even for toric links and knots. So again, to get an answer for a toric link, which is parameterized by two letters N and M, you should take something trivial, a product of characters. Which characters to choose depend on what you are studying. So after a full beta deformation to get super polynomials, you should take a product of McDonald's operators and then act with some operator. Only it will not be quite as simple as here. It will not be just M0, W0. It will be something a little more split, but also absolutely elementary. So just two words about AGT relations. So there are plenty of things which one can say about this, but we understand already a lot, though still there is nothing like a proof of this relation, nothing even like a good understanding of what it really means. But at the moment, I think the least known things, least popularized things are enumerated here in this short list, and I don't mention things which everybody knows. So there is an old dictionary relating Young-Mills systems to integrable systems, which goes back to mid-90s. Many people contributed to making this list. Now we have a complete understanding of how to map n equal to super Young-Mills systems, their low energy sectors, of course, into one-dimensional integrable systems. Now, today, also AGT relation relates them to two-dimensional conformal theories. And in fact, and two-dimensional conformal theories are nothing but this special logarithmic matrix models. And there also is a kind of direct relation between one-dimensional integrable systems and these matrix models, though it is not very well understood. It is well understood only in this Nekrasov-Shtashvili limit, when just a quantization of one-dimensional integrable systems gives you this differential omega, which is the exact Zyber-Quitton differential in the story. So I'll probably so conformal block can be written in the form of this Fadeev-Datsenko integral in the theory of free fields. So what is important is that there are these screening insertions, and what is even more important to get the story correct, you should take two open contours in this theory, one ranging from 0 to q and another from 0 to 1. In this way, you get two letters, N1 and N2, which are going to become to resolve the degeneracy property of free field theory. Usually there are two conservation laws, which says that alpha is fixed and the sum of all four alphas is fixed. By introducing these additional parameters, additional screenings, you can resolve this thing and describe something general. It is a trivial thing to rewrite this integral in the form of matrix model, and what happens is that you get just some two integrals corresponding to two matrix models corresponding to these two pieces, to these two kinds of integrals, and you get this single mixing term here. No, he said something about measures, but let me not go into this. So what is important is that this mixing term can again be split in the following technical way. It is decomposed into a sum of four characters. And what is important, this is a double sum over four quantities, and it can be split in two different ways. That's the usual Haber-Stratonovich duality. You can sum it in one way and sum it in another way, and you get two different decompositions of the same quantity. And ideally, one could dream that this Haber-Stratonovich duality is exactly what AGT relation gives, describes. Unfortunately, it is not like this. Instead of this, this thing decomposes conformal block into sum of something, which is labeled by pair of Jung diagrams, but the something are not Nekrasov functions. And just a simple example for beta different from 1, from beta equal 1 it is, but from beta different from 1 it isn't. And the simplest example is just this simple case of the level 1, where decomposition of this looks like this. So these correlators give you a formula of this type, and it is then decomposed into two Nekrasov functions with additional poles at z equals 0 at this, in this example. This is a phenomenon which I mentioned to you. Of course, in this case, you cannot say what decomposition is preferable, but in general, as I said, Nekrasov functions are factorizable, and these correlators, these Zeltberg correlators, are not. And the simplest example when it is non-factorized is given here. So this is what the Zeltberg correlator looks in general. It is a sum of two decomposable quantities, but with non-trivial coefficients. So natural quantities like Zeltberg correlators are not decomposed naturally into nicely factorized Nekrasov functions. So AGT duality still has something much deeper in it, probably, than just this Hubbard-Stratonovich duality. So my time is over, so I'll tell you nothing about this. Just I promised a formula which substitutes this decomposition. Here it is. So in the case of Homfli polynomials, you can expand the Homfli polynomial for a toric knot into a sum over Schur characters. This formula has immediate deformation to McDonald case, to non-trivial beta, which gives you a super polynomial for, in this case, just there are two differences. First of all, three differences. First of all, the Schur character is switched to McDonald dimension. The usual quantum dimension is switched to McDonald dimension. Then this W operator is decomposed into two pieces as usual. And the last, the coefficients are a little less trivial than they were here. They were just integers. Plus, minus 1, 2, and so on. In general, there are corrections. So this is an example. So they are made, again, from some natural quantities called C-bar, which are similar to the Homfli case, with some trivial correction factors, which you can write in quite a general form. There are many differences from Homfli case, but all of them are quite describable. And you can check a lot of things about the superpolynomials. Since we don't have any a priori theory which give for us superpolynomials, it's always a piece of art. So whenever you get something, you need to at least check with the literature what is reproduced, what is not. And this is usually your only argument. And of course, there's another argument that this is quite non-trivial to get a polynomial, especially with integer and positive coefficients, but still. Well, so this kind of formulas are consistent with everything what is known at the moment, with one notable exception. They are not consistent with the Hopf-Link superpolynomials. And that's, in fact, the only place where something is known for non-fundamental representations. And as I mentioned, non-fundamental representations differ a lot, because this is the first place where McDonald dimensions are no longer polynomials, even in some restricted sense. And it's a matter of dispute what is correct there. Definitely superpolynomials exist, but it is far from being clear if they should be reproduced and how they should be reproduced. So there is a kind of controversy here. Let me just note that that the only example known for non-trivial non-fundamental representation in another case is recently obtained by Aganajic and Shakirov. No, unfortunately, not quite independently, but that's the same kind of ideology, though the method is more sophisticated, more clever, and still, of course, with that result, these simple decomposition formulas do coincide. But because of this controversy with the links, it is a little less clear what is the right choice. The basic problem there is what to choose for our knots, and it's a matter of dispute. So the open problems in this field, no, there are infinitely many. I mean, just infinitesimal problems arising from this kind of decompositions are listed here. And especially interesting is the question of what happened to non-toric knots. Actually, this method which I described, it allows you to calculate iterations of such toric R matrix with which you can act on whatever you like. You can start from any knot. You cannot get an answer for this knot itself, but you can easily get from a superpolynomial for this knot, superpolynomials for all its descendants when you attach this additional braid to it in any quantity. And from this point of view, it looks like it should convert superpolynomials into superpolynomials, at least. Sometimes it does. And I mentioned one example that a knot 5-2 in Bar-Natan's classification is mapped in this way to 10-139. But for example, 4-1, for some strange reason, is not mapped into anything. So it gives a polynomial with coefficients which are integer but not positive, whatever it means. Okay, my time is definitely over. Thank you very much for your attention, and sorry for this mess.
There's actually something that really puzzles me about why a not super polynomial is a good idea. Because it's supposed to be, if I understand properly, the Poincaré polynomial of Kovanoff homology, and you can always define it. But I don't know any situation in which there's any useful physical method to calculate the Poincaré polynomial of anything. The reason is that you're supposed to count zero energy states, but it's very hard to know whether a state has exactly zero energy. And there's no way to calculate the Poincaré polynomial of anything that's easier than just computing the spectrum and finding out which states have exactly zero energy. So I don't feel ideologically that
yeah, I understand
that
the
it's
question.
A good idea to introduce the Poincaré polynomial.
I tried to mention this. There is no reason to believe that any method of this kind can work. But let me once again emphasize that what I was speaking about is not really a physical method. It's not a deep method. The problem is that we don't have any underlying theory. We don't know how to better deform Chern-Simons, for example. We don't. The problem which Ed mentions, as I understand, is that there is no reason to believe that these superpolynomials are given by something like index theorem in this case. Am I right? Usually when you introduce this beta parameter, you switch from minus to power something to some letter t into some power, which... Yeah. Exactly, but... Exactly, but the problem is that that after beta deformation, it is not very clear if we stay in the field of ordinary quantum field theory. Now, for example, it's definitely discrete type of theories. For example, many integrals are substituted by Jackson integrals. Now, many things happen. So it is not very clear if our usual intuition is going to work. Though that's, of course, a very serious drawback of any attempt here.
Well,
yeah. I appreciate it, of course. and the picture in my mind just illustrates that there can be additional hidden symmetries which are not obvious in any way. So what I was trying to say is that you have an answer, a nice answer for Homfli polynomial, which has an immediate, no, formal, if you like, deformation. So why not to try? So it is unclear if it will be successful, though there are, in some cases, there are arguments that it should be successful. For example, when you attach, as I mentioned at the very beginning, that you can evolve any superpolynomial into superpolynomial, this looks almost like a theorem there. Now, model of some difficulties related to our definition of our matrices, but in better deformed case. In any case, you can try. So. Definitely superpolynomials exist. Definitely there should be some method to get them. Definitely they can be decomposed in McDonald dimensions. All these things are obvious. So you should just calculate coefficients and see if they are nice or not. The forecast, which you probably imply, is that these coefficients will be bad. Sometimes they are, sometimes they are not. And of course, there is no concept at the moment. But physics starts from experiments.
I tend to believe that the generic case would not work, and that when it works, there's a very special reason which one should be trying to find.
Yeah, I fully appreciate this, yeah, but I think still we should be brave enough to try. And what I try to say is that despite all these obvious objections, sometimes things work. And that's a kind of unexpected, if you like. But that's what makes it interesting. Okay. The whole story about finding something hidden, which is not obvious. If there is something obvious, that's, no, in my mind, is a little less interesting. But
well, shall we? Oh, Sergei.
No. All what I'm usually doing, as you know well, is in terms of formal series. I hate phase transitions, but just I couldn't avoid mentioning this. So all these quantities are formal series, whatever they are. Phase transitions appear when you try to sum up some series and do something. But again, these phase transitions, no, in fact, I was referring to a well-known story about so-called complex beta ensemble, where already looking at this one-point function, which I mentioned, you can see that for small values of beta, no, it is described by something similar to semicircular distribution. When you start to change beta, it starts to fluctuate. And at some point, it becomes these fluctuations become small, and they fill a whole interval. And instead of this semicircular thing, you get just a step function. And at this point, there is numerical evidence that that the free energy is jumping some of its derivatives. So it's an observation, again, no understanding. The best thing achieved in this direction is a calculation of the first terms in the free energy exactly by Shakirov, by the way. But it's not enough to see this phenomenon. What phase transitions should mean for super polynomials, I cannot even imagine at the moment. Yeah. No, you can make a lot of speculations, yeah. No, nothing clever, I can say at the moment.
So Samson.
I just have a quick comment that about this formal series. The every computation in gauge theory in omega background is analytic. It's not a formal series expansion. It's an important property to prove that there's a function of epsilons, q's, and everything there. It's actually convergent. So this is important there.
Definitely. Just I was trying that I'm saying very simple things. Of course, there is a real science behind all this. Yeah.
Okay, let's thank Alyosha again, and then we have
thank lunch. You very much.
We should be back at 2:30.